Welcome back. Of course, we did just give you some tips on what to do as you get to stay home. And well, the good news for movie lovers or film lovers is that Netflix has released about 300 movies that you can actually watch when you are at home and, you know, not get bored. Well, as we get to move on with the Q Breakfast Show, do not forget that you can catch up with us on our Facebook page. That is QTV Zambia. Let's get interactive and tell us what you're up to on a Friday like this. In the studio right now, I am joined by Ms. Nalucha Zira, who is the country director for Action Aid Zambia, and also we are also joined by Mr. Noel Simukonde, who is the acting executive director for National Union for Small Scale Farmers of Zambia. Good morning, welcome to the show.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good
morning.
It is great to have you this morning.
Thank you.
All right. Now, how would you describe the budget allocation to the agriculture sector in the recent years?
On our part as ActionAid, we have noted that the allocation towards the agriculture budget mm-hmm. has been declining, mm-hmm. Going by trends analysis. For instance, 2018 was about 6.2%, mm-hmm. 2019 was 6.9%, and the 2020 has declined to 3.2%, which mm-hmm. is about 25% reduction. Mm-hmm. And this largely can be attributed to the debt servicing, as most of our national budget has been allocated towards debt servicing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And what does that mean for the agriculture sector?
Well, what that means is that if you look at the agriculture sector in terms of our 7th National Development Plan, mm-hmm. it falls under Pillar 1, mm-hmm. which is around economic diversification and mm-hmm. job creation. So what that means is that the agriculture sector is not being allowed to perform to its ultimate in the sense that it's one sector which has been prioritized for job creation, mm-hmm. but also to boost food security in terms of the country and also contribute towards strengthening the national reserves. However, what we are seeing in terms of the commitment, in terms of actual financial resources, mm-hmm. is not speaking to that. So mm-hmm. we are seeing a discrepancy between the intention, as it is in the 7th National Development Plan, mm-hmm. and the actual money which is being allocated to the sector.
Okay. And Mr. Simukonde, what is the mandate of the National Union for Small Scale Farmers of Zambia?
Thank you. Thank you to our viewers. The mandate of the National Union for Small Scale Farmers basically is to support small scale farmers and emerging farmers to ensure that they're able to produce food in an environment that is acceptable. Mm-hmm. And production and productive levels, production and productivity should be enhanced if they are supported adequately. Mm-hmm. So as a union, we are a farmer organization whose pillars stand on lobby and advocacy mm-hmm. in the whole value chain of the agriculture sector. We also work towards linking farmers to markets. Mm-hmm. We also do farmer organization. The last but not the least is training and research.
Mm-hmm.
Because these components, they're very important. If farmers are really going to achieve or work towards attaining the objectives in line with the 7th National Development Plan, mm-hmm. from what my colleague has indicated, mm-hmm. surely we really need to be focused as a country mm-hmm. and be able to align our finances towards ensuring that the smallholder farmers, the commercial farmers, and everyone who is engaged in the agriculture sector is supported adequately.
Mm-hmm. And how are the levels of accountability in the farming sector so far?
Well, there seem to be a number of gaps, mm-hmm. a number of challenges. The issues of corruption, mm-hmm. I think, they are prevalent. The way FISIP is managed, mm-hmm. the way FRIA, I'll give a scenario where we are, a very practical example, where we are going into the marketing season.
Mm-hmm.
The way the purchasing of this very important crop, which mm-hmm. is a staple food, maize, for example, is done from production, that is from the way the inputs are given. So we're talking about the FISIP in totality. FISIP, like in the current marketing, in the current agricultural season,
mm-hmm.
has not been done very well. We have instances where farmers in this era where first of all, we had started to develop on changing from the traditional FISIP, which is just giving inputs to farmers and fertilizers, to using the e-voucher.
Mm-hmm.
E-voucher, according to the research that has been done, was the best. But we changed, government decided to change back and just give inputs, which is just giving fertilizers and not the preferred inputs that the farmers need. But they were just given maize. Many of our farmers were just given meat and fertilizer. So
mm-hmm.
when we're talking about diversification, we are defeating the whole purpose. Under e-voucher, diversification is done in a much more, in a much broader perspective, because
mm-hmm.
farmers have a wider choice. They're
mm-hmm.
even able to access livestock. And now we are going back to where we had started. So
mm-hmm.
the challenges are there. FISIP has not been managed properly. And even FRI, we see the challenges that FRI has had.
Mm-hmm.
It had to compete with other players, to fail even to buy the quantities that they required in the last year. So basically what we are saying, there are a lot of issues that need to be attended to. And
mm-hmm.
as government, we would want them to engage, to be more engaging, and engage CSOs, engage other players in the agricultural sector, even the business community, those that are participating on the base of business
mm-hmm.
in the agricultural sector. Let them engage them. Let them engage them in the budgeting process, in the implementation process, so that at the end of it all, we are able to get this country where it needs
mm-hmm.
to be.
As ActionAid Zambia, what are your thoughts around accountability as far as resource management is concerned?
Well, for ActionAid, what we have noted, the benchmark we use is
mm-hmm.
the Auditor General's reports.
Okay.
So if you have followed the Auditor General's reports as well as the Financial Intelligence Center reports
mm-hmm.
over the years, the trends reports, they are pointing to issues to do with mismanagement and abuse of public resources.
Mm-hmm.
So it's from there that where we are basing our findings to say we have noted an increased levels when
mm-hmm.
it comes to public finance management abuse.
Mm-hmm.
And year in, year out, various audit general reports which are coming out are in red for this country. But we are not seeing corresponding measures in as far as tackling the findings from there, but even just in terms of the nation being updated, what has been done, what has happened to the people cited in those reports, the ministries as well as the departments.
Mm-hmm.
At higher level, we see that in most cases, we've just seen transfers of even permanent secretaries,
mm-hmm.
which in itself is transferring the problem from one ministry to the next.
Mm-hmm.
So with that, we have seen an increase in terms of abuse of public resources. And in response to that, ActionAid Zambia, with the support of the Switzerland Development Corporation, has been implementing the Sustainable Development, the SDC project,
mm-hmm.
which is a 5-year project where we are working to build the capacity of small-scale farmers organization, as well as selected media houses, as well as targeting around three parliamentary committees, that is the Parliamentary Committee on Agriculture, the Health, as well as the Budget and the Budget Committee, in terms of looking at building their capacity when it comes to issues of accountability
mm-hmm.
in as far as the national budget is concerned, because at the end of the day, Parliament have a role, an oversight role, in terms of ensuring that the budget is implemented and there is credibility with matters to do with our implementation of our national budget. But also, we have seen that the budget itself also can act as a tool for corruption, in the sense
mm-hmm.
that in the way that it's structured. And for instance, if you look at our national budget towards the agriculture sector, 50% of those resources are allocated towards FISIP and the Food Reserve Agency. So meaning the bulk of the budget is globaled by two institutions
mm-hmm.
and the next is around salaries and administration. And very few goes towards things to do with research
mm-hmm.
as well as building on the agriculture sector. And yet we have seen the ramification that climate change is posing on the country and
mm-hmm.
agriculture being a key sector towards building national food security. We should be investing more in research, but also in diversification of the agriculture sector. but that doesn't seem to be going on well currently, as very few resources are allocated to those areas. And it's our appeal that even the Food Reserve Agency, it's mainly its focus has been on marketing one crop, which is maize.
Mm-hmm.
But if you're going to talk about diversification, probably there is need to look at a crop marketing authority,
mm-hmm.
which will encompass almost everything, and not just crops, but also even the diversification into livestock, as we have already seen with the e-voucher, which is giving wider range of choice to our farmers.
Mm-hmm.
So if we could also think of a marketing strategy that encompasses the diversification that we have set ourselves on as a path as a country.
Absolutely. But also, coming back to you, Mr. Simkonde, what are some of the challenges that small-scale farmers face, and are they also included in the budget?
Okay. Well, thank you very much for that question. Farmers are facing a number of challenges, and I'll start by demonstrating these problems, challenges that smallholder farmers go through. Number one, there's lack of finance. Financing of these smallholder farmers is not adequate. They're not getting adequate support in this line, because if they are going to increase their levels of production, the levels of poverty, if they have to go down, their levels of production and productivity have to go higher. The challenges that are there is that you see many farmers of land which is basically not on title, it's on traditional land, and for them to get money in order to expand their businesses, many, even when we would say we teach them, they would be able to be taken to trainings of getting farming as a business, but as long as they don't have the funds, it's really harder to them to progress. Number two, also the issue of markets to our smallholder farmers. The current markets that are there, yes, they're there. We're not saying they're not there. But I'll give an example, like the actual market that we in the biggest city of Lusaka. We have the biggest market where farmers converge, especially in horticulture production. I'll talk about this crop, I'll zero in on horticulture, because under very good management, the profits that are there in horticulture are more than 100%. And farmers can make income using by producing these crops. So it goes back to financing, and also these markets that are there, like the Soweto market, which again, this market just chokes the farmers. You
mm-hmm.
find that farmers, they take their produce, which they are really worked for, hard to produce, and what they get are peanuts. At the end of the day, they're agents that get the money,
mm-hmm.
get money from them, and the farmers just get maybe even 30% or less than what they are supposed to get. Number three, we will look at extension services. Currently, the extension services are between one extension worker to about 800 farmers, saving 800 farmers, and this is a big challenge. While the standard is one extension officer to about 400 farmers. Now, when I want to talk to what country director started
mm-hmm.
with. In line with the 7th National Development Plan, where agriculture has been blessed to be the key sector to drive this country, if we are not able to bring on board or find solutions to the extension services that are currently not very healthy to our smallholder farmers, then we will be talking, we will not be aligning the policy direction to the reality of this country.
Mm-hmm.
So there's need actually to put more money into the provision of extension service, so that the numbers can reduce, so that there's efficiency. Now, again, on just extension services, just having trained extension services, that extension workers that have been trained over years
mm-hmm.
and are not adapting to the current technology of what is needed in order for the farmers to meet the trends of today, we will not also progress, because currently we don't need just extension services of a motorbike or maybe a car, but we need gadgets. For these, they need to be equipped with the modern. Now we're talking about digital way of communicating to our farmers. So messages can reach our farmers. We can also use, they can also use the computer. It's not that the farmers are not so illiterate. So basically, we are talking about having technologies that are advanced in terms of technology, in terms of the current trends of today. So these are some of the things, but there are many more challenges, but these are key because they are in the line where if they are not attended to adequately, farmers not produce to reach the exportation targets.
Okay, and how would you, describe the extension service provision to farmers?
Well, I think the small scale farmers has already alluded to. Currently, it's very choky,
mm-hmm.
as we are failing beyond the required threshold of one extension officer servicing about 400 farmers, and
mm-hmm.
What is currently obtaining on the ground is different.
Mm-hmm.
So you find that with that already, it means we are not giving the adequate attention to the small-scale farmers, and yet we know that the small-scale farmers have been the drivers behind the various bumper harvest that this country has recorded.
Mm-hmm.
And with that, we are not really addressing the needs of the small-scale farmers.
Mm-hmm.
And that's where we see a lot of the wastages which are coming up and losses in agriculture. Mainly, some of them arise even at the time of storage,
mm-hmm.
some of them even at the time of harvest, because there isn't much support provided to the small-scale farmers. So if we are able to address some of these issues in the value chain of the agriculture sector, then we'll be propelling the sector towards greater heights in as far as being the next sector to offer employment opportunities, and as well as in terms of creation of job creation in the country, because currently we are largely dependent on the mining sector, and yet
mm-hmm.
studies have shown that the agriculture sector in Zambia has the capacity to provide, to be the next sector in terms of addressing issues of unemployment. And this will largely be driven by issues to do with diversification, as well as value addition to the various agriculture products which have been produced by our small-scale farmers, as well as the commercial farmers. And also, there are quite a number of cartels in the agriculture sector which we feel that the policy makers and the government need to pay attention to and address,
mm-hmm.
more especially when it comes to the marketing.
Mm-hmm.
At the end of the day, the people who are making losses are the actual farmers. So if you look at what they've invested in and what they're getting out, it's not really making much in terms of improving the welfare of our farmers in this country.
Mm-hmm.
So therefore, there is need also to look at how the actual markets are being monitored, but also how are they being set up in order to address that the farmers are able to get the much needed profits from their produce. In such a manner, we'll make agriculture more attractive, as we are trying to say we want to see a lot of young people getting into agriculture, but young people won't go in a place where already there are issues to do with where you're being milked. So these are some of the issues which we are hoping that our government will address. And we also know that the agriculture policy is currently under review.
Mm-hmm.
So we are hoping that it's broadened to also look at issues and address issues to do with crop marketing,
yeah.
as well as markets, the ordinary markets which the local, the small scale farmers usually interact with.
Mm-hmm.
And for us, our interest as an institution is that you find that the bulk of the small scale farmers are women. And even when you look at the patriarchy in our society, even when it comes to agricultural practices, I'll give an example. If you come from a southern province, you know that the best time to plant groundnuts, the bigger ones, which are much of value when selling on the market, is around the rainy season. But usually women only have access to the fields when post-rainy season. So even the groundnuts that they will produce are the smaller ones, which have got which sell less on the market. So these are some of the issues that we are working to address, even as we are engaging with small-scale farmer unions and organizations, such as their organization in the project that we're implementing as Action Aid, but also paying attention to the gender dynamics in the agriculture sector. How do we address them? How do we make the agriculture sector more viable to the women of this country?
Okay. Now, the talk of the day now is obviously the COVID-19, with the coronavirus COVID-19. And, in Zambia currently, there has been 39 cases that have been reported. And I would also want to find out, what is the impact of the COVID-19 on food security?
Thank you very much for that very important question. This global disease that has affected mankind with no exception really needs us to step up by engaging in activities that will really mitigate the effect of this disease even going further. Let me talk about the impact that this disease has had on the agriculture sector. Just the last 2-3 days, I've gone into the city to check on the markets and see the current prices. And the prices of the commodities of goods, of products, whether it's crops, whether it's livestock, whether it is, it's coming from poultry, they have all gone up. I was amazed yesterday when I went to some market and found the price of carpenter going for 5 kg per bucket of carpenter going for 250 kwacha.
Wow.
The other experience that I had was the price of beans in the same market going as just by yesterday going as high as 200 kwacha. Now, when you try to find, I tried to find out what was the reason behind that. Those that sell those products in these markets said actually they are not having these products coming. The farmers are not coming. Not that they don't have the crop, they don't have the produce, but they are not moving. So because we are constrained with moving by the challenges that this disease brings forth, it can crumple our agriculture sector. It can crumple our economy. That is a bigger picture that we need to look at. And as Zambians, we need to look at this disease with the seriousness that it deserves. From the agriculture sector, from the union sector, we just want to urge our farmers to be able to observe what has been recommended by the Minister of Health so that we fight this disease. We can prevent this disease so that at the end of it, or now that we are not able to have imports, we are not able to do exports, we need to work around our country in the agriculture sector, ensure that we have the crop, we continue producing, but at the same time, we observe all the guidelines that are there so that this disease that basically escalates when we move carelessly, when we don't observe the health standards that have been set, will really impact our country. And ultimately, when agriculture sector is crumpled, the economy of this country might go on its knees. So it's a very big challenge, and we need as farmers, we need as citizens, to be able to respond to the advice that we are given.
Yes. Any additions?
Well, it's just to ask the country to rally behind the Ministry of Health during this challenging time. It's not a very easy period for the country, but the world at large, as COVID-19 will have huge ramification when it comes to the world's economy, and Zambia's economy won't be spared. And one of the things, of course, our economy already is at distress, with already the huge debt servicing that we're incurring. Therefore, we're in a very precarious situation, and it's calling upon everyone to help, to come to the aid of government in terms of dealing with this COVID-19. It needs the concerted efforts of each and every Zambian. We can help and support in any way without even just being able to provide the much-needed resources, but also helping in terms of following the instructions that we are being given by the Ministry of Health to try and stop the spread of this disease. So that is my appeal to the country.
Absolutely. Thank you so much for coming through to our breakfast show this morning.
You're welcome.
All right.
Thank you.
All right, so we do move on with our Q Breakfast show. We'll be having a look at some of the stories making headlines in our international news today. For now, we break for a commercial. We'll be back on the other side.
loud and stuff because I'm really shy and held back when I'm around people. So a friend of mine gave me this much vodka.
Yeah.
I don't take vodka. And he just told me down it. Just take everything down.
I'm not bragging. I'm good.
Yeah.
Competition, I don't see it.
Are so manipulative, like they want to convince the public, you know, somebody, you know, do you know the kind of girls always complain, this guy broke my heart, and you know what, I used to take care of this guy.
Rapid fire questions. Whiskey, wine?
Whiskey.
Beef, chicken?
I said Thai. Chicken.
Road trip, studio session?
Studio session.
And lastly, Slab D, market it.
Market it.
Hi.
In the last 24 hours, we carried out 160 tests. And out of these, we have confirmed 3 new cases of COVID-19. And all the 3 cases are secondary contacts to 2 separate COVID-19 confirmed cases. These are all second or third generation contacts of people that travel to COVID high risk countries. And so what we are saying here is that we have a couple. One was working for a contact of a person who traveled to a COVID-risk country, and that person transmitted to the spouse. They all stay in one compound. So that's those two. Then the third one is a pharmacist who worked with one of the doctors who we said was positive, providing further information and evidence that local person-to-person transmission is now occurring in our communities. Cumulatively, that brings Zambia's COVID-19 cases to 39. This is out of the 752 individuals that we have tested by end of yesterday. All the cases that have tested positive are under our care in our isolation facilities. We continue to monitor and trace all contacts, and we continue to respond to alerts. As we get alerts, I would like to emphasize what Minister Information has said, that let us ensure that we protect the rights of these suspects and patients as we carry out our work in the media. I wish to urge all market managers to ensure immediate implementation of the prescribed trading standards and hygiene requirements, failure to which they shall be closed. The law provides adequately for closure of any place that is described in the judgment of the authorized officer as an infected place. So authorized officers who anchor on the Public Health Act, Statutory Instrument 21 and 22, to ensure that they protect the bigger population from the risk of COVID-19. It is for this reason that we urge personal responsibility, collective responsibility, and comply. Enforcement shall be enhanced, working with our colleagues in security wings enforcement to protect the greater public from this transmission. So if you are trading or applying anything you're doing in a place that is not conducive and you're not observing social distancing, countrymen and women, let us ensure we heighten use of masks, and let us ensure that we use masks that we can afford. There are masks that are made of cloth that are actually reusable. Some are on sale, some you can make at home. Protecting yourself from the next person who is affected or from the environment is extremely important. Masks do not need only be these masks that we're putting on here. You can make reusable masks out of cloth and engage our teams in the communities to support you on that. Let us wear masks.
One of the important issues to observe is that we must not stigmatize the disease. It is very important that we continue to show care, to show concern for those who might be infected, for those who might suspect that they are infected, And it is important that we allow the medical practitioners to continue to observe their ethics as they deal with patients and potential patients of corona. And also, it is just kind to be able to allow those who are patients and possible patients the privacy they deserve at all times, and especially during this time. I think let us not focus on fighting each other. Let us focus on fighting corona as a disease. And I think for my colleagues in the media, you are part of the front line. We have to observe our ethics as well. We have to report about corona in the best professional manner, and we must continue to observe citizens' privacy, as well as to respect the other group of health workers who are in the front line, and these are the health workers who also have to observe their ethics. I want to emphasize this point. What would be the benefit of Dr. Chilufya, or government in general, not sharing information with the public? No one wins in red alert. And then secondly, it's not even about who is sick. We should all be concerned about the numbers. How many are sick? Because that's the only way we can be protected, if the numbers are less. So if we focus on who is sick, we're not going to get anywhere. And I think the
Welcome back. You're still watching the Q Breakfast Show, and it is time to just remind ourselves and also talk about the COVID-19, how it is transmitted and what exactly it is. And we do have, from the Public Health Association of Zambia, we have Mr. Cholwe Mabo, and also we do have Mr. Enoch Mutwa, and they will be telling us more about the COVID-19. As you know, the number of confirmed cases still stands at 39, and we have also one death recorded from the COVID-19. Good morning. Welcome to the Breakfast Show.
Good morning, and good morning, listeners.
Absolutely. It's actually the viewers.
The viewers, indeed.
Okay, so I think it's you know, good to remind ourselves, you know, all the time, if it's every day, because this is a global pandemic that has affected almost each and every person in the world. Now, tell us more. When we say COVID-19, what exactly is this?
Basically, when you talk of COVID-19, we are talking of a family of viruses which cause respiratory infections. Mm-hmm. This can be a common cold, mm-hmm, or a severe disease. Mm-hmm. COVID-19 is an infectious disease which is recently discovered. Mm-hmm. It was discovered when there was an outbreak in China in December 19. Mm-hmm. Sometimes it's called a zoonotic because it transmitted from animal to human. Mm-hmm. So an animal can have that disease and transmit it to human being. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that is briefly about COVID-19.
Okay, but how exactly is it transmitted?
COVID-19 is transmitted via droplets. Mm-hmm. So somebody who is having it, they can cough, sneeze, even having just a contact. Mm-hmm. Because the virus itself, despite it being self-limiting, mm-hmm, it gives a chance when you're in close contact, somebody coughs, and because it takes time for one to notice that they have it, so in close contact, it is able to be transmitted to the next person.
Mm-hmm. Just on that again, when someone's got COVID-19 coughs, mm-hmm, then those droplets, they go on a surface, mm-hmm, and when someone comes into contact with the surface, you'll be able to get. That's why we are being told to sanitize our hands, mm-hmm, because times to time we do come into contact with objects.
Okay. Yeah. I think there's a lot of circulation when it comes to, you know, even false information when it comes to some of the signs and symptoms. But, you know, coming from the Public Health Association of Zambia, what are some of the signs and symptoms of the COVID-19?
When you talk of signs and symptoms, the common ones are fever. Mm-hmm. When someone's feeling fever, what he needs to do is to call the medical personnel, mm-hmm, then they advise, instead of that person to go to the hospital. The reason is they want to prevent that person from spreading the infection. Mm-hmm. The other one is dry cough. When you have that dry cough, report. The other one, you may have fever. Okay, mm-hmm. I've talked about fever. You may have also, to some people, diarrhea. Also, when you have that symptoms, report to the health personnel, then they'll be able to advise.
Just to add on the signs and symptoms. because the disease is a respiration
mm-hmm.
infection, so we're having issues with breathing difficulties.
Mm-hmm.
So we find others are having breathing difficulties. And when we make mention of dry cough, the sputum is dry, like it does not have a lot of mucus. It's dry, so you're able to tell this one is COVID-19.
Mm-hmm.
Apart from the difficulty in breathing, we're able to tell somebody's having some tonsils. So there is tonsillitis beginning to build on the tonsils of someone.
Mm-hmm.
So there we're able to tell this is COVID-19.
Mm-hmm. And also, what's the incubation period?
So the incubation period for this disease is about 14 days.
Mm-hmm.
Now, because our makeup, the human anatomy and the physiology of individuals get to differ. So others, even at the day 12, they may have more of the symptoms. Others, it may even take to 16. So we have given it an average of 14 days, depending on how the body responds to the causative of the disease.
I think that's why they are even emphasizing on self-isolation. The moment you feel fever, go on self-isolation for 14 days. By then, the symptom will be able to show. As he has alluded, it can go up to 24 days
mm-hmm.
for the symptom to show. So if you are not in self-isolation, what will happen? You transmit to many people.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Now, from the cases that we've heard from worldwide, we've heard certain people being cured, you know, they are free from the virus. Is it treatable?
Currently, there is no medicine for that.
Mm-hmm.
But the government and the WHO, they have put preventive measures,
mm-hmm.
which each and everyone needs to follow.
Mm-hmm.
Preventive measures like washing our hands thoroughly with soap. Because the reason is that we do come into contact with objects.
Mm-hmm.
So most of the time we need to wash our hands with the soap. Then sanitize our hands with alcohol-based
mm-hmm.
hand sanitizer. That one will help to kill the bacteria. Again, self-isolation. If you are not feeling well, you've got fever, put yourself in 14 days self-isolation. And report to the medical personnel, then they will come and they will advise you to the right facility. Then the other thing also, they have more emphasizing on self-distancing.
Mm-hmm.
No wonder they have even said no bars, no churches. That is to help us prevent COVID-19.
Mm-hmm.
And if I got you right, you made mention of people recovering.
Mm-hmm.
If this disease is curable.
Mm-hmm.
Currently, there is no cure.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not curable, but people are able to recover depending on how the immune system is.
Mm-hmm.
You know, each one of us, when you're infected with a disease, a body produces the antibodies against the infection which has come.
Mm-hmm.
So people are able to recover depending on how the body has responded.
Mm-hmm.
There is a way which they are trying to treat symptomatically depending on how the infection is.
Mm-hmm.
Despite having no cure and no vaccine at the current moment.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so are you doing enough, you know, as the Public Health Association to inform people out there about the COVID-19?
Yes, currently the message has gone throughout the country. It has been reduced even to our local languages so that people are able to
mm-hmm.
to understand and to read. There are a lot of preventive measures which have been put in place. As you may know, in Livingstone, all those truck drivers coming in,
mm-hmm.
they are putting in isolation for 14 days. The reason is to prevent them from spreading the diseases.
Mm-hmm.
In our villages, information has gone there to sensitize people about this disease because
mm-hmm.
it's infectious. If someone gets it in a family, everyone in the family can be able to be infected, and it can bring impact to the community and to the family at large.
Mm-hmm.
That's to add more. When we talk of information distribution,
mm-hmm.
we are trying by all means to do the promotion, delivering the information to the community level.
Mm-hmm.
Like my friend alluded, when we talk of languages, we have made sure that another wing of public health, which is Zambia National Institute for Public Health under the Ministry of Health. We are working in collaboration with them so that we make sure we put it at least in 7 languages which anyone can access. The Luvali, the Tonga, Silozi, people can have access to it. And not only that, but also Zanese has come on board to partner with us so they can go move around with their megaphones and even just teach about how to prevent this disease. So we are trying by all means to give the information. Not only that, but also musicians have come on board. Chef and Mark too, they have sung a song about it. So they are talking about COVID-19, how we can prevent it. So we are making sure that we bring all stakeholders. Actually, the community is a very key stakeholder in the prevention of COVID-19. So we're making sure everyone is able to get the information, even in comedy, hard vets on TV, so that people get to know more about this and how they can prevent themselves.
Okay. And do you think that we're adhering to, you know, the measures that the ministry has put in place?
I can say yes. If you go in our communities,
mm-hmm.
people are able to follow the guidelines which the ministry have provided for us.
Mm-hmm.
If you go in the bus stations, before you enter there, you need to wash your hands.
Mm-hmm.
Even when we came here, first and foremost, we are told is to wash our hands.
Mm-hmm.
Those are preventive measures. There are some companies which have closed because of the same. Why they are adhering to what the ministry are telling us so that we stop the spread of the disease.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
All right. Well, thank you so much for coming through to our breakfast show today.
Thank you so much.
All right. All right. So we do continue with our Cure breakfast show. And in some international news today, billions of desert locusts are ravaging over fields and farms in East Africa. They are eating away almost everything that's green and destroying the livelihoods of millions. So how can the locusts be stopped before they cause severe food shortages or even famines in Africa? So DWTV brings us more in this report.